won't go back.
Well, the opening, I want it to be very stark and harsh for a number of reasons, because the incident is so upsetting, and we're really not seeing the incident exactly as it happened. We're seeing it as it felt to Mort. So whether it was snowing or not that night, I don't know, but I wanted it to be snowing and windy and cold. I wanted the movie to snap onto the screen. I wanted to cut on, not fade up, just a guy's face and have him looking right into the camera and just wonder, oh, who's he? He seems upset. What is he doing? Why is he sitting in that car? Now he's going backwards. Why is he doing that? Where is he going? Now he's stopped again. What's with this guy? You know, I wanted to really draw you in with a lot of questions. That first shot, I wanted to just say, this is our guy. This is who you're going to be following. Pay attention. So it's that close up on him. It's a hood mount on the car. Stays right on his face as he, you know, decides to leave that parking lot, and then he stops and decides to go back. And then I wanted him in the same shot to back away and reveal where he was, because we didn't know where he was. So what we did is we had the hood mount on the car so Johnny could do all the crazy kind of driving he wanted to do and be as aggressive as he wanted with the car. And then when he stops, we cut and removed the camera from the car, you know, took the hood mount off and put it on an arm over the hood of the car and lined the shot up as exactly as we could with the previous shot. And then in one of the wiper passes, we did a little digital trick, and it's the new shot. And so you see him back away in what appears to be the same shot. And you see Motel in the background, and you think to yourself, oh, I think I have a feeling what's going on here, and I think I don't like it. Making the snow, and making the night, and making the red Motel letters, and everything in that scene is either black, white, or red. At least that was our intention. If you go into the Motel room, you see the production design in it. Everything in it is black, white, or gray. Later, at the same Motel, when you see Ken Kelch there, you realize, oh, in fact, it's that kind of disgusting Motel room orange. You know, the colors are very rich, but that's not the way Mort remembers it. He remembers black, white, and then and the red of passion and anger and murderous rage.
David really showed himself to us on the first night, showed what kind of a director he was. We were in the Motel room, Tim and I in bed, and Johnny storms through this Motel room, and it's snowing outside and this whole thing.
I didn't want to hear anything anybody said, because I feel like it's all stuff we've heard a million times, and it's also seemed suddenly way too personal, and I wanted to get out of that room, you know, instead of hearing everybody scream their recriminations at each other. So, and I also wanted the actors in the room to seem, you know, shocked and as if they'd been awakened rudely by a madman.
And how David set it up was, the room was completely dark, there was no people in there, no cameras. This never happens on a set, by the way. Tim and I laid in bed for, it must have been 15 or 20 minutes.
So I didn't tell him, but I put a bunch of great big stereo speakers in the room and rigged the lights in the room to go on when the door opened. You know, we had an electrical board with, you know, huge switch we were going to throw. So, and then I let him sit for a while and didn't really tell him when we were rolling. So
we didn't hear him call action. We didn't know when he was coming in the door. We didn't know anything. And so the next thing you knew, the door burst open and these loud speakers came on with this crazy sound. And it was so real, and we got so freaked out, you know, you couldn't help to react to that.
I think they were quite startled. We do put a little bit extra with his scream because that was Johnny's idea. He understood I didn't want to hear any dialogue, and he said, I feel like I want to just go up to the bed and scream at them, sort of like using voice as weapon. And it seemed like a great idea, so he did it. And then we just kind of helped it out a little bit in post to give it a slightly surreal, upsetting quality. Well, first of all, you want to establish setting. And since Mort doesn't get out of the house that much, we have to get out of the house. And the time to do it seemed like the main titles. So I want to say, look, here's where we are. See how isolated it is. That's why we start out so wide. Nobody around except this tiny little house here. Then we move closer to the house here, and we keep lining the house up in the dissolves, you know, to get closer and closer. And then we have the shot that wraps all the way around the house and comes in what we learn later is the secret window. And across the desk to see what he's been working on. It's clearly a story about what happened to him 6 months ago, and he hasn't made much progress, and what he has isn't very good either. And then out over the railing, and then we see a mirror. My idea was that we pass actually through the mirror. We go into the mirror and find the guy on the couch, which will seem a little odd to the viewer, but you'll forget about it. You'll think, well, is that a window or a mirror? Whatever, there's a knock at the door. I guess I better pay attention. And my idea is this is a visual clue. We are entering his consciousness. The rest of this movie now is going to be subjective. It's going to be from his point of view. We are going literally through the looking glass into the crazy guy's head. Then if you're watching later at the end of, toward the end of the movie, when Mort has gone full-blown crazy, and Shooter gives him the hat and says, now you better end your story, Mort hears Amy's car, he turns around and sees the car, and then we cut back to him, and when we can see the driveway in the mirror behind him, we move past him and into the mirror again and find ourselves out at the car with Amy.
Mort?
Well, in fact, what we've done is come out of the mirror, and I'm telling the audience, you're no longer now in his point of view. Now you're back in an objective reality. So everything between the mirror shots is either occurred wholly in his head or was tainted by his craziness. Everything on the outside of him is the way it happened. I figured, where do you go after something like that happens in your life? And you'd go to the most peaceful place you can possibly imagine. So we found this gorgeous lake, Sacacomi, in Montreal, or outside Montreal, which is just like upstate New York, where it's supposed to be, same mountain range. We found a spot that we loved, that worked, that had water surrounding it on two sides instead of just one, and built a cabin there. And then we built the interior of the cabin on a stage. We did shoot some interiors on the cabin at the lake because it's dressed out, but it's smaller. We cheated by about 5 feet in depth and 5 feet in width because the piece of land there was small and we had to fit the cabin in. So anything you see looking out of the cabin with maybe a wall in it is usually on the location. Anything looking in is usually the set.
Now, where was I?
The idea is that the cabin's womb-like. That's where it's supposed to feel comforting and warm. And Fred Murphy, the cinematographer, shot it very richly. And Howard Cummings, the production designer, used a lot of very rich colors and made it look like a place. I would always go into that cabin and say, I really need one of these. I really need, everybody on the crew was saying, I need a cabin just like this on a lake like this. Because the idea is you retreat somewhere safe. And then if that somewhere safe turns on you, then you're really in trouble. If you go into a great big creepy house, of course bad things are gonna happen to you. If you go into a comforting, soothing, restful place and bad things happen to you, well then you really got a problem. Well, Johnny's look mostly came from Johnny. You know, we certainly our costume designer, Odette Gaduri, had a lot of ideas and brought a lot of stuff. And he sort of picked what he felt most comfortable with. The bathrobe he immediately sparked to and wanted to wear for the whole movie. I got it down to not quite the whole movie. But I think it's a great thing because to him, it was a security blanket is the idea.
I work with the director, but a lot with him, with Johnny. He had some ideas that we chat together and we tried a lot of things. And finally, we took the direction of working with the color, the mid-tone color, kind of color that they were very strong, but they fade down like under the sun. It's a kind of twilight zone. Everything is loose, everything is fade, and the texture are hemp and cotton. So I work with the technician to age and dye to have the right tone. Compared to the flashback and compared to the other character where the color is more bright, more colorful, more happy, he is lost, so it make him more vulnerable.
He came in with the glasses and hair and his general look he came in with. I think most good actors have pretty strong ideas about how they think they should look for a part, and he certainly does.
You stole my story.
Seems like he stepped out of the depression. You know, he seems like he's John Turturro's character is a very tough, thing to do because he is a phantom. He's a figment of imagination and therefore has to seem somewhat imagined. But you can't give away the fact that he's made up, that he doesn't really exist. So his look was going to be extreme and his look was going to be different. And it was pretty much just verbatim. I just took King's description of him in the book, in the novella, and put it in the script, and we came up with that. I mean, the big struggle was the hat. How big is too big? How big is, you know, how big is too small? How do we keep it on his head? How do we keep it stiff so it doesn't, because when it became floppy, he suddenly looked like the Scarecrow. So we spent a lot of time on that, but it was really just as described in the novella. And then, of course, in retrospect, when you think about the movie, you think, oh, well, no wonder he seemed a little over the top. He was made up.
Shooter, John Turturro, is wearing, it's not the black, but I want a strong silhouette compared to Mort. So I use color as a base, like beige, brown, and gray, and we put it in the dirty water just to make him look like black or dark color, but it's an almost black, it's smoky, and for me it was a kind of shadow.
I don't think you're really all that well. Stealing from another man, that don't seem to have ever bothered you none.
John worked on the accent with through tapes and interviews with a dialect coach, and came in with it. And the problem with the Southern accent is it does tend to slow you down because the vowels are stretched.
Didn't have the stomach to do it yourself, but you knew I did.
So it's tricky to do a Southern accent and yet keep up the pace of what you're doing. But I thought he did a great job with it.
I did not steal your story.
Oh, I expect you'll let yourself go to Green Haven for murder before you'll admit it.
I have the magazine, you lunatic. I have the magazine!
Finding what is any particular person's greatest fear is, I think, King's gift. And one of the reasons a horror movie will work or not work. I think for a writer to be accused of plagiarism is to be accused of being nothing. All you have is your story, and if it's not your story, then you don't exist. Which is why I think I like Shooter's panic on the road when Johnny says he's gonna get the magazine at 3 o'clock, and Shooter seems for the first time truly scared.
There can't be any magazine. Not with that story in it. That story is mine.
His panic is because if there is a magazine with that story in Mort's name, he doesn't exist. And I think that's a frightening thought.
You bring me that story, if it exists.
Johnny and John are both so experienced, they must have 100 movies between them. You know, we didn't require a lot of rehearsal, nor would it have been very advantageous because they're not supposed to have a great familiarity with one another. So we mostly read the material to see where does it work, where doesn't it, how can we finish the writing, and then just threw them at each other. And they're both very responsive to what the other one's doing, and they looked like they were having a lot of fun. I don't shoot a lot of takes because I think they're both so good, you tend to get what you need pretty quickly, you know? What's fun is you can throw stuff at them just to see what they'll do, just for fun, because they're gifted actors. Books tend to be about what people think and feel, and movies are about what people say and do. So this one was a particular challenge in that there's a lot of Mort's thoughts. It's all Mort's thoughts. He's in a cabin alone. There's nobody to talk to. That's why I had him talk to his dog so much in the beginning, because it's a chance to get to hear what's on his mind.
I didn't steal it.
And we do hear his thoughts a bit as the movie goes on.
This is not my beautiful house. This is not my beautiful wife.
But it's very tricky because you gotta hear his thoughts and you gotta hear him talking to himself without, you know, tipping the hand that he's a lunatic. And we tend to think of talking to yourself a lot as crazy behavior, even though we all do it. So when we hear Mort's thoughts in the movie, whenever we hear them, he's always addressing himself as you. He doesn't say I, or, you know, he says,
so you know what to do, just do it.
You need to do this, or don't do it. He's instructing himself so that his inner voice I wanted to present as a separate character.
No bad writing.
And then later in the movie, he literally becomes a separate character who exists flesh and blood, and we realize, oh, he's not just hearing his own voice in his head, he's seeing himself. There's really something wrong with this guy.
If you don't go ahead and bite her, I'll kill her.
Well, it used to be a cat. In the novella, it was a cat. And I think Stephen King and my girlfriend both suggested, why don't you make it a dog? I mean, you know, what kind of man gives his love to a cat? Come on, it's a dog. You know, then we'll really hate this guy. So I made it a dog, and then because I couldn't leave well enough alone, I made it a blind dog. As I cast this 10-year-old dog with cataracts that kept bumping into things. And in fact, on one shot, if you look at the shot where the dog walks out the doggy door, he's sort of staggering off to the right and then redirects himself toward the thing because that's because his trainer was whistling outside.
All right, go ahead and be discouraged, you blind bastard. See if I care.
Anyway, that's Chico. The decision to kill the dog was not, I'm a dog killer from way back. I killed a dog in Lost World. Got plenty of mail about that. Nobody cares about, you know, I mean, he also kills 4 people in the movie, you know, I don't know. That seems mildly objectionable to me. But it's a way of sending a message, surely, to a character that you're serious. And it's a relatively easy way to get the audience to hate your bad guy.
I'll get you for this!
After the dog is killed, he has to take steps. You can't just go back in your cabin and go to bed. You have to do something. So he does what anyone would do. He goes to the police. However, in this case, it's a sheriff who doesn't seem too concerned about what's happened and who happens to be arthritic. It's a small town. Not a lot goes on there.
Needlepoint. Can you believe it? Doc says it's good for the arthritis.
And Johnny's character is just not really comforted by that. So he moves on, and he looks for somebody who can protect him, he thinks. And he goes to town and meets the Charles Dutton character, who's a private investigator.
Which kind of situation is this? Is he a regular wacko like you've had before, in which case I can help?
A much more reassuring and authoritative figure than the local sheriff was. However, he's also expensive.
You remember my rate?
Yeah, an obscene fortune, right?
These are now expositional scenes, and you need something more. There's a lot of information you have to hear, but you need to be entertained while you're hearing it, and those are usually great opportunities for some humor if you can find it. So in the private investigator scene, what I wanted was to have a timer, like a lawyer might have on their desk, and that when Dutton agrees to take the case, he clicks a thing and it starts ticking.
My story came out a couple years.
Meaning the money clock is running, and then when Johnny gets offended by something he said, he turns it off, and it becomes a bit of a chess match back and forth, which is just a nice, subtle thing, but I think helps you through the scene. The scene where he hears a sound upstairs, right after Kelch has left, figures, you know, right after your protection leaves, and that's when you hear the scary sound. It was a very difficult scene to do because, again, there's nothing there except his fear and the fact that he's hearing things. And the smashing of the mirror is another big clue, which I'm sure some people will pick up, that there is nobody except him. And he's seeing his own reflection, and for a good reason. So it was tricky to pull off because there's really nothing there and there's nothing for him to be scared of. And therefore nothing for us to be scared of. And there's nothing to cut to. It's not, you can't shoot it like standard suspense where you cut to the guy hiding, you cut to him, they don't see each other, back to him, back to the guy hiding, they shift positions. There's a sequence I understand. I know how to shoot that. Since I can only be in his point of view, it's very difficult to make suspense. To the extent that we did it, I think it worked. But it was hard. It was deceptively hard because it seemed like it ought to be easy.
I killed the mirror.
There's also a thing I did in Johnny's character, Mort, is continually flustered by young women whenever he sees them in the movie. So you see in the sheriff's office, the sheriff's niece is there, and she laughs at something, and he finds her just flustering. And then in Dutton's office, a young assistant comes in carrying a tray of something or other, and it really throws him off his game. And later in the movie at the post office girl seems to throw him in. The idea is, of course, that, you know, he's had this bad experience and he's having these homicidal feelings toward women, and so young women make him very, very nervous. But then at the end of the movie, when he asks the young girl out on a date, I thought it was a nice perverse twist that now that he's killed 4 people, he's tanned, rested, and ready and wants to date. I just thought that was kind of funny.
Hi. What?
Someone burned down our house.
Are you all right?
The house that we found, the house, the white happy house that you see, is in a suburb of Montreal, which we thought looked a bit like Riverdale. Our job then was to find a lot that basically matched it and build a burned down version of that house. Strangely, the owners would not let us burn down their house. And, you know, we wanted to set a whole scene there, so to do it with any kind of special effects didn't make a lot of sense. So we found a lot that looked like it and then sculpted a burned down tree that would match perfectly. And then we lined up those dissolves so that they would match perfectly in the driveway. And, I think we did a very nice job of really making everything match so it looks like the same spot.
Really sorry about all this, Amy.
So am I.
Me too. Thank you, Ted.
Ted is an interesting character in that he is, by the way he's presented from scene one, he's inherently unlikable. He's an interloper. He's an adulterer. He's cuckolding the movie star. You know, we can't have this kind of behavior. This is terrible. So we're sort of predestined not to like him, which is why I cast Tim Hutton, who is pretty much the soul of empathy. So I like that our feelings are very ambiguous. You know, Hutton, we're used to having sort of warm feelings toward, and he certainly conveys, I think, a lot of warmth and regular guy-ness and a sense of sort of suburban safety. But he's not a nice guy. He stole a wife. He's a wife stealer, for God's sake.
Bother you if I answer one or two of these, Ted?
And so when I was talking to Tim about the possibility of him doing the part, I think he said something about, there was a scene that used to take place in the hallway outside the insurance company where they have a little bit of an argument.
I'm real sorry you had to miss that. I know how much you like my things.
Johnny's character says something to me that pisses me off, so I say, all right, you and me are gonna have a little talk.
I'm in trouble.
So when David Kep and I met for the first time, we talked about it happening on the sidewalk, which then happened and allowed us to actually film in New York, which is great.
Yeah, look, marriage is in. I'm sorry, but I didn't end yours.
And then I started thinking about this idea of the bus, which, you know, Hutton's so wrapped up in talking to him and telling him to back off and stop bothering them that he's backing him up toward the end of the street. And then a bus comes by. We're left to wonder for a moment, Was he thinking about pushing him in front of the bus? Was that a coincidence? What exactly happened there?
Are we getting the message I'm sending?
And I think there's a lot of ambiguity around Tim's part, which is good. You know, it's a wonderful thing in a movie to wonder what's going on until it's a terrible thing. Then there's a fine line. Same thing applies later, actually, when they're at the gas station.
I think you know what I'm talking about.
Well, Teddy, I think I do, but here's the problem. I don't respond well to intimidation. It makes me feel icky.
Whoa.
Again, it's ambiguous. We're not quite sure. We know Mort is talking about Shooter very clearly if you watch the movie a second time. Ted is talking about Amy. So when Mort says something like,
where's your buddy?
Ted's natural thought is, well, he means Amy. And he says,
came alone.
And when Mort says,
go back and tell that to your filthy little friend.
He's referring to Shooter. Ted takes a swing at him because he thinks he just called Amy filthy.
God!
That scene was essential to the red herring of thinking Ted might be behind it all, but not cheating. There's no cheating in that scene. Nobody ever says something just because the movie needs them to say it. They say it because that's what they really mean. Now, the trickiest moment in the scene is when Mort says,
I buried my dog, mister.
To which Ted looks away in a manner that could be interpreted as guilt and remorse, or it could be interpreted as, Jesus, this guy's a lunatic. I see what Amy's been talking about, you know, and I think the look plays both ways. Well, the idea is all build up and then very quick payoff. I think that's the stuff that I find most effective. I think his walk to the car is the heart of the scene. And then the discovery of the bodies is incidental. That's conveying information we need to know. It's almost expositional. And the shorter it is, the more effective it is. I also use his head a lot. In all the scenes at the path by the lake, there's always a take where the camera is behind Mort's head, following him. And in this case, I was using his head to block the information and make the scene more interesting, to make us try to want to lean around his head to see what's in the car, and that draws us further into the scene. And in the first scene at the lake, when Mort meets Shooter for the second time, we're following Mort's head and he stops, and then the camera drifts to the left, revealing Shooter leaning against his car, and they start their dialogue. And again, it's another visual hint that this character grew out of his head, literally, and doesn't really exist. But in the scene where he discovers the dead bodies, the idea is to approach the car as slowly as possible, withhold the information as long as possible, and then get it out very, very quickly. And then my favorite part of the scene is Mort staggering back and turning around and looking at the squirrel, and I'm not really sure what that means. I just thought the idea that the squirrel knows is somehow upsetting in some way or another, and just an odd detail. It's that kind of thing when you're having a slightly out-of-body experience like discovering dead bodies must be, I'm sure it's the strange detail that you remember, like there was a squirrel there, and I thought that gave it some character. I think it's just more effective when you imply rather than show. You know, it's an old movie lesson that people keep learning over and over again, or someone rediscovers and everyone says, oh, what a genius, he didn't show us the fish or the ghost or the alien. I think that what's not seen is always much more upsetting than what is seen. And I thought that I liked the idea of covering the guy's eyes in a, you know, POV dead guy shot where the paper comes over his face and then we hear we can imagine what a screwdriver being pulled out of a head looks like, but if we really shot it, and we did shoot it, you know, it looks like a screwdriver being pulled out of a plastic head, which is not so terribly impressive. But in the darkness, sitting there alone in the dark theater, hearing the sound of what we imagine is a screwdriver coming out of a skull, it's really squirm-inducing, I think. Some suspense. And I felt like that was a great opportunity to have a, you know, what looked like a simple endeavor, push this car over the cliff, turn into a potentially life-threatening thing. And that his watch gets caught, I think, just made it kind of fun and exciting. I was trying early in the movie to suggest he has a vivid dream life. So there are a couple dreams in the movie, very brief. I just wanted dream images, really, more than full-fledged dreams. For example, early on, he sees his door banging off the hinges, and then he sees a shadowy Shooter figure moving through it. And they're just images because he's had this upsetting encounter and somebody's banging, trying to get into his house, or banging, trying to get into his subconscious, or out of his subconscious. And then later, the scene where he wakes up on the couch, rolls over and sees a deadly ocean rock, sees at the top of a cliff and there are rocks below with surf crashing on them, and falls off the couch and thinks he's falling off a cliff and then lands on his floor. I think I was trying to do two things. I was trying to suggest that he has a vivid dream life, vivid inner life, and another hint that he might be imagining other things. Also, I just liked the idea, we've all had that thing where when you're falling asleep or waking up, you think you're falling. And you catch yourself and realize you're not, and I wanted to put that on film. We actually got that cliff footage from Lost World. I didn't want to have to go shoot, and I didn't have time or money to go shoot such beautiful footage, so I asked Spielberg if I could have some of the B-roll from when the trailer's hanging over the cliff in the Lost World, because I remember they had great stuff. So he gave us that, so thank you, Steven.
Very quiet, here we go, and roll it.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank God.